following interview was conducted with Professor Samuel Postlethwait for the Purdue University Oral History Program. It took place on Thursday, October 11, 2007, at his residence in West Lafayette. The interviewer is Katherine Markee, the Oral History Librarian. Welcome. Tell us a little bit about your early years and where you were born and schooling.
So I grew up in West Virginia. I was born in Wileyville, West Virginia.
What was the date of birth?
April 16, 1918. And I lived most of my life on a little farm there out on the west called Alistair Ridge, a place called Alistair Ridge.
Okay.
And so lived there. Oh, sorry. Are you able to edit and...
Oh, yeah, you'll get the copy to look at.
Yes,
sure, sorry.
You can edit out this guy.
So, born your school community was very small?
Very, well, it was just a farm.
Okay.
And the nearest people who were about a half mile away on the West Virginia hills, you know, they're very, very steep hills. We farmed, my mother and I essentially did the farming with a team of horses, and it was just a subsistence farm. It was not to make money. My dad worked in the oil field, and so he was going all day and tired at night. You know.
The oil fields in West Virginia, though? Was that where he was working in West Virginia?
Yes,
okay.
There. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Okay. What was school like? Was your class? I bet grade school was pretty small.
We had a two-room schoolhouse very nearby, and the first four grades, I mean, and then the next four grades in the next, yeah. And so I went, started when I was about 4 years old, actually, because there wasn't anything else to do, and the school was there, and we didn't have rules like everybody has.
It was a lot easier.
Nowadays. Yeah, so it's no problem.
So, do you have any brothers or sisters?
I have one brother, and I had three sisters.
Okay.
And still one.
Where would you go for high school?
Went to Reeder High School. I started high school when I was 11, and my grandfather became ill, so I spent the year then with him, helping with him. But we went with my dad then to take my dad to work. My dad had an old pickup truck, and he built a structure over the back of the truck. And so there were three of us, my sister and me and my neighbor, rode in the truck with my dad, and my dad stopped at his office where he was going to work, and then I drove from there another 10 miles back around to the school, to the high school, and did that for 4 years.
Wow.
And we had there were kids along the highway. This was before that we had such a thing as bus transportation, and so the kids that were going to school the same place as we got near the school, they'd piled in the back of that truck as
you
well.
You ran the bus service.
Yeah, I ran the bus service, and it was 12 years old when we were doing this. Yeah.
What fun thing.
Yeah. So I didn't have a driver's license, but nobody else did either. So I didn't bother anybody.
What was like, were you in any clubs in high school or athletics or anything?
Not athletics, uh-huh. Because it was not possible with the travel arrangements there. But we did have a glee club and a few things like that.
Sure.
And an occasional performance or two.
Okay. You know. How large was your graduating class?
18. 18 kids.
Okay.
Yes.
And what year did you graduate from high school?
That would have been, let's see, I can't think right off.
That's okay. Yeah. But then you went on, that's okay. Went on to college, now what was
went
your
on
choice?
To, yes, went on to to a teacher's college, Fairmont State Teacher's College. At that time, the state had several teacher's colleges, and you could go to those colleges 2 years, and you would get a what they called a standard normal degree, which allowed you to teach then in a country school. And so when I was 18 years old, now I had it, the standard normal degree, and I did my first year of teaching. It was at Hickory Knob, West Virginia. It was so far back that in order to get there, and I had to walk 2 miles just to get there. There, I had 15 students, and I had at least one in each of 8 grades, so I had all 8 grades. Tremendous experience. Wonderful.
Was it in the town where you lived, or?
No. Oh. This was. We're talking about country schools. We're not talking about, even if we were talking about towns in West Virginia, that wouldn't be very big. But these were the location of schools like that, where they had tried to locate that. excuse me, locate them within 2 miles of. Most kids, and most kids were expected to walk 2 miles to school. That was reasonable.
Sure.
Expectation. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. So I taught there for a year, and then I went back to school and got my bachelor's. And
at the same school that you got your
Fairmont State College, and then came back and taught another year, and then at Hickory Knob. The next year, Sarah and I got married then, and the next year I was teaching in a two-room school, so that was a promotion. I started out at $98 a month, and each year they increased your salary by $2 for 1 year, and the next year would be $3, and then $2 and $3. Excuse me. That was a practice. And so my wife's mother passed away around Christmas time, so after that we moved to Grafton, West Virginia, where her grandfather and uncle lived, and she was taking care of them. And I taught there in Grafton, taught mathematics in junior high school. But that summer I also enlisted in the Navy, and I was an officer in the Navy, became a communications officer, and ultimately ended up in Kittery, Maine, outfitting submarines, and I was the operations officer then in that port for the rest of the war.
This is World War II?
World War II, yes. Okay. Yeah, yes. And of course at the end of World War II, the GI Bill paid more, much more, than Hickory Knob. And of course, I get up my master's degree then from West Virginia University, and my PhD from State University of Iowa. And from there I came then to Lafayette in 49.
How did you happen to come to Purdue? Was this after you got your PhD?
Yes.
Was there an opening? Or?
There was an opening here in the Botany and Plant Pathology Department. Dr. Caldwell was the chair of Botany and Plant Pathology. So I came in the School of Agriculture. Dean Butts was still dean then. My office first was in the old ag building. I home. And then the taught in the Ag Hall adjacent, you know. And the Lilly building was in the process. And so we moved in. We were looking forward to moving into the Lilly building. And for a while, while the building was still under construction, had an office in the Lilly building and still teaching in Ag Hall. But spent several years there with the botany and plant pathology group. There were four of us who taught freshmen. There were two botany courses and two zoology courses, one in agriculture and one in biology. And so eventually they decided to put these two courses together into one course, and that became my botany course, which I taught from that time then until I retired in 1984.
Okay. Yeah. That brings up the auto tutorial. How did that come about?
Well, in 19...
Some comments on that.
In 1957, I went to England on a sabbatical, and primarily to just look at different instructional situations. And when I came back, I kept thinking, surely there must be something better than three lectures in a lab approach to learning. And I was concerned enough about the students who were not able to keep up with us that I was talking to Dave Moses one day, and Dave said, well, why don't you make make lectures on tape? And he says, we'll just post them here, and the students can come and listen to the lectures. And so that sounded like a good idea to me, so I started doing that. And I would sit in my basement and with a tape recorder. And as I began to make lectures, I began to think, well, hey, the students could have their textbook in hand. So why not have them open the textbook while I'm talking with them? And then, I'm reasonable, they also have a laboratory manual. So why not have the laboratory manual and the textbook open, and I'll just say to them, you turn to page so-and-so, and let's talk about this a little bit, and I'll let me ask you some questions, what do you not know about this, and so on. And then a little later, it just made sense, since we've got the laboratory manual and the textbook, why not have a twig there? Why not have a leaf there? Why not have a microscope there? Why not have any of these things? And pretty soon, by the end of that semester, I was making a kind of a tutorial, if you please, with the materials, same materials that I was using in the laboratory. I was just simply sitting among those materials and talking as if I were talking to an individual. And the product, that's what we put over in the audiovisual. Well, one day, toward the end of that semester, some person in my course came to me and they said, I can do just as well over here in the audiovisual as coming to class. Do you mind if I don't come to class and just do my own? Well, I was kind of offended at that, but, well, go ahead, you know, fail my course if you want to. You need me. So, but at the end of the semester, she had done very well. And so the next semester, I decided, why not take my course? We had around 380 students in the course at that
time. Is this a freshman level course?
Freshman level course. Why not just take a section and have them all do their studying over there, and let's see how they come out, and see if they come out as well as those who taught conventionally. And by the end of that semester, they hadn't done much better than those that I taught conventionally, but they hadn't done any worse. And they had done it at their leisure and at their own convenience. So I gathered those students together and said, look, let's redesign a whole instructional program in botany. You help me. And we'll talk about the things, the components that a good instruction ought to have. What do you think? And so they said that they felt a little bit out of it and they'd heard about my lectures and the good jokes, and so that everybody ought to have an opportunity. So we've set up a one meeting. We decided that we ought to have one meeting a week where it was a general assembly session. Everybody was there. And then it seemed that there ought to be a time when small groups got together. So we had what we called a small assembly session. And so then the other session was an independent study session. And so the next semester, I went to Henry Koffler, who was the head of our biology department, and told him that I'd like to do this now with my whole course. And actually, he didn't think that was a good idea. I'll put it that way. And after about a week, though, he called me back in and said, well, demonstrate this to some of your colleagues. So I brought in some programs with some of my colleagues, and they went through and looked at it, and they didn't care. And so he told me, well, okay, you can buy, how many tape players do you need? I said, well, I need 22 tape recorders and a learning center. We will make a learning center, and the students will come to this learning center here when they please, and there will be 22 stations to accommodate 380 students. So he said, okay, buy tape recorders that they use over an audiovisual, so when you're through with them, you can sell them back to them. So
more mileage.
And so that summer, I spent building with my own hands 22 booths in the new learning center here. And
where was the learning center located?
It was in the basement of the Lilly building there. And so, but I built those on the top of the tables that were already there and made them into booths.
Listening booths, in other words.
Listening booths. And so during the summer I had made all of the programs, gotten them ready, so that each week we would insert a new set, a new mini course, if you please, and so the content was now divided into mini courses. Well, I had gone away on vacation for a couple of weeks, and when I came back a week before school started, and I called the purchasing agent and said, where are my tape players? And he said, well, we're still trying to get a better price. Classes start next week. Well, I said, can't help it. we'll get these when we can. Well, it turned out that this was good for me because the day that class started, and I had to, you know, the General Assembly, they were scheduled right just like conventionally taught students. I came in very, very dejected and very, very upset. And here were 380 students facing me, and I was telling them, I started telling them what I was trying to do and what had happened. A young lady in the back raised her hand. She said, "Can you get one tape player?" And I said, "Well, yeah, I think I can get one." She said, "Well, just go ahead and we will sign up to come in. And come in for 2 hours, and we'll just have sign-up sheets. We'll come in and we'll play the tape, and all of us will do the same thing." Well, what happened then was that the first month or so, they did that, and they looked forward so much to the opportunity to be independent and do independent study that. Here I now had 380 people who were on my side, and they were the students who were, and so they, you know, they just gave me high ratings, and really, from that point on to after my retirement, I always had students involved in helping me look at what we were doing and asking, how can we do it better? How can we do it better? And they gave me very, very good ratings. Well, it turned out after about a year of this, you have to realize that this is not too long after the war.
World War II?
Yeah, World War II. And that people had expected after the war was over, that technology was going to take care of everything, all of our problems. And so lots of people started thinking that somehow a tape recorder now in a classroom would take care of all of their problems. And a lot of teachers thought that they were thinking in terms of a lecture on tape and providing a lecture. And this was not, audio tutorial was never that. It was always tutoring a student through learning activities with the idea that learning is done by the learner, and it's what you have the learner do that causes them to learn here, and not what I do that makes them learn. So that the design was always on bringing the students into contact with plants in such a way that they knew and understood plants. And using all of these other things, the textbook and lab manual, all of these were tools then to enable the student to come into contact with plants. But then along about that time too, a graduate student somewhere, I forget where Megger was, but anyhow, he came out with a little booklet on objectives. And the use of objectives, and we call them behavioral objectives. In other words, you were looking at students and saying, now, you need to be able to do these things. And if you can do these things, then, and like, you need to be able to take a twig and identify five structures on that twig and tell what the function is. And so we did that. We adopted that. And so each of our mini courses, if you please, had carefully written objectives telling a student now what they needed to be able to do. And we now became a team working together to help the student do those things. And if they did them, we had no concern about what their IQ was or what their background was or anything. If they did them, they were able to do them. And so they got credit for that. And we also defined what it took to be to do a B level, and what it took to be an A level. And so the students knew precisely, and I knew precisely how and what they needed to do. But we again were together on this as a group. I trying to help them the best I could, and they also helping each other, because they were not in competition now. They were only in competition for the subject matter. And of course, this distorted the curve. But down on Hickory Knob, you had one student in first grade, and how could you curve that one student? And we got along perfectly well, and when the student knew something, they knew it. And why not give them credit?
They've mastered the objectives that were set.
They've mastered the objectives. Now, some of there were students who were programmed to conventional instruction that didn't like the idea of mastering here, because they liked the percentage, because you could get a passing grade without knowing the subject matter. But in our situation, they could not. But the entire group working together and started working together, that all began to become, and so we very seldom had more than a 5% failure there. And to fail in our course, you had to reject it. You just had to decide that you're not going to learn botany. And if you're not going to learn botany, well, that was okay with me. But you didn't get credit just because you were attended. And so what also happened was that some students who had a very good course in high school, and there are lots and lots of good high school teachers, wonderful teachers in high school, and so they brought to the course lots of information already, and they didn't have to waste their time with the things they already knew. Yeah. And so we could have, at the very beginning of the semester, the test out situation, so that some students could test out of this many courses, that many courses, whatever. But in the meantime, we had still the meeting once a week that they had the opportunity to, and there are some things that you can do in a large lecture hall that you cannot do in an independent learning situation. People need people, and they needed each other, but the small groups that we had, it turned out that these were 10. We finally had an oral quiz session, so that we gave oral quizzes once a week, and so that the small group session became an oral quiz, and we had a table that you could rotate. And on it were the materials for each objective that we had for that week. And so the students now sitting around the table here, the table would rotate to whatever student. So every student had to be ready. And what we were trying to exploit there is, everybody says that you really learn a thing when you begin to teach it. So we had then, actually, the course kept growing, but we finally ended up with over 800 students in the course. But we would have 800 teachers, if you please, because each student would teach about whatever their section was,
sure,
and whatever happened in front of them. and they would take the objective. And again, we're saying this is like the scientific method. You have to know what the problem is and define the question. And if you know what the problem is, you're much more likely to solve it than if you don't know what it is. And memorizing information for information's sake is a difficult way to learn. But if you know, and so each objective was a problem here, and a defined one, so that they could know when they got there. And so people said, "Oh, won't they cheat here?" Actually, we put a similar table. Then we finally come to the point where we put a similar table in the learning center. And what happened was that the students now would go up and teach each other. And so I had all of this extra help of teachers. Plus, I gave students who made an A in my course an opportunity to come back the next semester and get an hour's credit for teaching in my course. And so, when we had around 600 to 800 students, there would be around 30 of those who would elect to do this. 30, and those students now had an obligation, one, to spend 2 hours a week in my learning center helping whoever needed help. Two, to do something in my course to make my course better. And then, of course, the first question, what do you want me to do? And I want you to think up something in my course that will make it better. Now, I think we're talking about 30 plus students who are now looking at my course and saying, I've got to do something to make this course better. The creativity of those 30, then they were A students as well, you know.
Sure.
Not all A students did this, of course, here, but and so they did such wonderful things, and what a pleasant thing it was to be working together with them to do that. The other thing that they had to do was to meet with me 1 hour a week. And we would look at what we had done the preceding week and ask ourselves, how could we have done this better and made more students successful and more successful with this? So, and this course then kept evolving and evolving and evolving over all of those years. And even it was never the same any semester from one semester to the next. And each of the students could see what they did and what their suggestions could see them being implemented. Even as they were students, not only just the ones that were taking the hours credit, students during the course got the same message, and they would come to me and they say, Sam, now no offense, but you know what, if you had done this here at this point, well, of course I was not offended here, because it was our course, not my course.
Sure.
It was ours. And the graduate students that I had helping me too, they were just wonderful people that struggled with me to try to do it better. After about 2 or 3 years of this, people begin to hear about the use of a tape recorder as a part of the instructional design. This up to this time, the use of technology had not been as an integral part of the instructional design. It had been, you know, sure, we had movies and that sort of thing.
Sure.
But this was a part. And so people began to come and visit to see what we were doing. And the first person that came, I was so flattered. You know, I took him to a steak dinner. So, but soon they become so frequent that over a period of time, I no longer could. I couldn't take time away from doing my teaching, and I was doing some research at the same time. And so I finally decided, look, if you want to come and see, you'll have to come on this date. So we set up a date, and the information with the people here in Purdue. The first meeting, there were around 470 people here, and there were teachers from all over, and there were, this was about 67, I think, or 68. When we started this, the testing and stuff was since 1961, and 62 is when we finally made the leap to the whole thing. So by this time, there were several people who had come that were also starting theirs in various places, and they had their own innovations and things. So they began to, that 420, that was an effective time for me, and relieved me some. The next year, we decided to do the same thing. And by this time, there were enough people involved that they were making their contributions to the whole thing as well, and not just mine anymore. And there were over 700 people at that meeting. And they decided that, and there were enough of them by that time doing audio tutorial instruction scattered all over. There were people from Australia, from South Africa, from...
There were
just all over. And in fact, even the American Airlines had a person, there were three of them. But anyhow, they decided to start an organization, which they did, and it was called the International Congress for Audio Tutorial Instruction. There were people from Germany and very active people in Canada and several other areas. But that organization continued and has continued and still meets. It changed names. There were a number of innovations back in those days of different from audio tutorial that also were individualized instruction kind of things. So all of those came together under this one head as International Society for Individualized Instruction then. And now it is called the International Society for Teaching and Learning, and it met, and its meeting will meet in October.
Does it meet different spots, or does
it meets at different schools, or not necessarily, early on it met at schools. And then, at this point in time, they meet near a school, and some representatives at that school kind of take the leadership in organizing the activities, the local activities. Of course, they have their president and treasurer. And
is it an international organization as well?
Yes, still international organization. Yeah, there were people in Australia and Australia, there, which was a fun time. Hawaii, South Africa, there was a vice chancellor in South Africa that came to Purdue to see what we were doing. And so he was saying, well, would you come to South Africa? And I really don't have time. If we could, how much would it take? I said, well, it would take the cost of my wife's travel as well as mine. Now, I never did have any fee. All of the travel that I did was, if they had extra money or had money, that was fine. And they'd just pay my way here. So this vice chancellor was determined that I come, and he called me, and he had everything arranged. I said, oh, indeed, I can't. Yes, you've just got to. So Sarah and I went to South Africa. He treated us so very well. And one of his teachers then came back as an intern here for a number of years. I had teachers come and spend a semester or a year with us. The Lilly Foundation funded several teachers to come and work with us here as interns. And the Johnson Foundation also funded some people here.
When these were caught on, when they were in the auditorium, as well as in high schools and in colleges,
yes,
primarily.
Several high schools, and Joe Novak was here at Purdue, and then he went to Cornell. And
was he in your department?
He was in the biology department, and Joe did audio tutorial with elementary school kids, and he did a lot of study on learning and how learning occurs, and used this as a tool. Out of Cornell for a long time. Several people did research of one kind or another on this. There was a lady in Australia that she published a book on her audio tutorial experience, and she documented, you know, very, very carefully the increase in involvement of students and the success of her students. The lady that just retired from Ivy Tech.
Oh, the one who was the chancellor? Dolmenberger or something like that?
She told me, I met her one time here, and she told me that she did her research, her master's, on audio tutorial.
Small world.
Yeah.
You mentioned earlier a question. You originally started in the audiovisual, but then when you got the Learning Center, that's where it was done. Is that correct? I mean,
yes.
You first just sort of went over to the
left.
Okay.
Yeah. Well,
until you got your own facility.
Yeah. The first 25 students was in the audiovisual
center. Okay.
The audiovisual people here were wonderful to me. They did a lot of things for me that they didn't get money for. I had no money source here. But one of the first things they did for me was they just brought in a movie camera and helped me put together a movie of how for the students, to tell the students, this is what we're doing and this is how you do it. Because back at that time, students were so programmed to three lectures and a lab sort of thing, that to conceive of them going about attacking learning themselves and being a participant in this was difficult for them. And very, very, very few people did any of that kind of thinking. So this audiovisual people invited me to go to Chicago, my first trip. You cannot imagine this old country boy, but anyhow, invited me to go to Chicago to make a presentation to an audiovisual meeting. And so it coincided with the time that the first version of this movie was available, was here for me. It was not narrated. So I took it to this group and stood there and talked it through there. And as soon as I finished, somebody in the back said, he was from Wisconsin, he said, "Where can I get a copy of that?" And I said, "Well, I don't know. I don't have copies of it. I don't know whether audiovisual people will have this or not." And so the auditor came back and talked to them, and they then helped me put the narration on this and made this. And there was a time that they told me that they had to have, I think, around 20 or 25 copies of this film available for rental. And they were, they started out, you know, and they had to keep making additional copies in order to take care of
it. Very good. Very good. You too.